Dudley Moore, and welcome to Concerto. We're going to hear some of the greatest music ever written in this series, performed by some wonderful soloists and accompanied by Michael Tilson-Thomas and the London Symphony Orchestra. And to start us off, we're going to hear a man whom I heard maybe 30 years ago when he was first starting his solo career and was still playing in an orchestra. And I kept on thinking to myself, who's playing this wonderful flute? These extraordinary sounds, where are they coming from? And it was, of course, from the flute of James Galway, who is a very famous soloist now and very much a household name. Add to that the equally renowned Spanish harpist, Marisa Robles, and you have a performance of the Mozart Flute and Harp Concerto that is second to none.
Together, please, the opening tutti.
Mozart's music is basically fun, and you know the first movement, for example, where it starts off like a trumpet call, and then there's this scale up with the orchestra. And then comes this very elegant ding 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 ding. It's almost like welcomes you into the piece.
It's not that Mozart did things that other people didn't do, it's just he did them so much better. The voice leading is perfect, the whole arrangement of it is perfect, because he had such a great mind. He could see all the possibilities and eliminate all those which were not the best.
Well, I'll believe you, thousands wouldn't, Michael. When was the harp actually invented? It's quite an old instrument, isn't it?
Well, you know, the harp was invented when the primitive man, believe me, this is true, I'm not kidding you, the primitive man found the vibration of the hunting bow.
Said what?
The hunting bow, hunting.
Oh, oh. The bow.
When the arrow went, heard little noise like...
Oh, missed.
And so...
Yes.
Yes. So did I. But you see, sometimes it would be very useful. You know, there are some conductors which I would like to go.
Yes, right, yes, yes.
I'm wondering, you know, when Mozart wrote this, he probably composed it on the piano.
Yeah.
And the piano upon which he played was a rather interesting instrument.
Mm.
People used to say they couldn't tell the difference between the harp and the piano, which is interesting, isn't it?
But it sounded more like there was a sort of a duck-like noise about the plucking sound that used to happen at the piano, wasn't it?
Well, Beethoven said when he tried these bigger pianos made by Graf and people like this, he said, "Thank God now we have a piano that sounds different from the harp."
Oh, really?
Unquote Ludwig himself.
Really? How would you feel if there was a pedal on the harp that was like a sustaining pedal? In other words, it was like a piano action. How would that...
Well, you see, Dudley, the thing is, in the instrument, we have the opposite problem. Because if you listen to this chord, for instance, now, any chord, but I will play C major chord.
Yeah, it resonates.
That is the sustaining pedal. Do you know what we have to do? We have to do this. It's the opposite. We have to dump as you play. All the time. Because if you leave it...
Just sort of...
Incredible. What we do have is the seven pedals. You being the pianist will understand this very well. That we have seven pedals in the lower part of the instrument, four on the right foot. And three, obviously, on the left. Yeah. We have pegs in here. I don't know if you want to come round sometime.
No, I don't want to come. Oh, I'm coming round. I'm moving round as we speak.
Yes, please. Because you see, I want to explain to you something very important. That's the flat.
Oh, I see.
So your string is the longest string, obviously, is the flat.
Right.
Now we press the pedal, one. You see that much has gone cancelled from there to there. That distance now is shorter. And now we have a C natural.
Right.
But now I press the pedal to the sharp position. See?
Right. And you choose?
And all the octaves. It is not easy, but if you start the harp when you're just about a few days old and then you can practicing until the day you die, then you basically will get somewhere.
Mozart actually made two trips to Paris. The first time, he was very young, he was in that stage of his life when he was sitting in Maria Antoinette's lap or kissing her.
Oh, I remember Marie, yeah.
And the next time he went back to Paris, he was now a young man, 22 years old. And this time, people didn't think he was quite as adorable. They thought he was rather frightening, actually. He had a lot of radical musical ideas. And
well, it was the acne period, wasn't it?
Well, I think it was a period where he was realizing that the sort of things he wanted to write were already too complex for the audience. He was really searching for work, and one of his pupils was a young harpist, an aristocrat, and her father was a dilettante aristocrat flutist. And he wrote this concerto for them, and it was actually for the daughter and the Count de Guin, or the Count de Guinness.
Count de Guinness, no wonder James loves playing this particular piece.
Can you live with that, Mike? Play it for me one time how you like it. Suspend. Yeah, I'll plant that. So I'll think about that over
suspend.
Lunch and change it. Right.
So Dio.
Does it bother you at all, the fact that Mozart was not really fond of the flute when he wrote? I'm sure that the flute that he wrote for was very different.
Oh, it was.
The flute that you played.
It was. But so was everything in those days, you know. Volkswagens weren't invented.
No refrigeration.
No.
A flute going off must have been a tremendous, you know, pong.
Well, you know, I think it had more to do with Mozart not being paid by the Comte de Guinea who commissioned this particular concerto.
You think so?
I mean, he was only writing these concertos for money in order to subsidize bigger things, like an opera.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I think he hated the flute, because he didn't get the loot out of these guys.
Mozart actually was somewhat disparaging about the talents of these two musical amateurs.
Tantes.
He knew they were not exactly the most sophisticated or the most musical avant-garde of their time.
Right.
And he wrote a work that was thoroughly accessible, very entertaining, very decorative, but he restrained somewhat the musical language of this piece. Now, meanwhile, he wrote a piece which is one of the most difficult pieces in the whole repertoire for harp, because it does make such enormous demands technically.
There are some bits in this that are incredibly difficult for the harp. And when you see Marisa playing them, it's a real scream. She sits there knitting away, you know.
Knitting.
Because, you know, knitting, to my opinion, instead of making like a harpist would make noises like that.
Very nice, I like that.
Was
that your opus 45? Yeah.
But hopefully, you know. That sounds better than knitting, I think.
I think so.
Well, tell you something about this. This is the
Do
first
you have
time.
To?
No. It'll give you some idea about Mozart's confidence in this young girl who played the harp, because you remember she was a young kid. And he just wrote really virtuoso harp bits. Mm-hmm. So you play the harp on a piano and I'll play the flute and we'll go to the next big tutti.
Okay, great. Right?
Mozart thought very much of the technique of 10 fingers, you know, like
yes,
the piano.
Yes.
And of course, look at what happens in the harp. We only use four. This.
You don't use the little finger at all.
So this little finger is totally useless. If I do that, then my thumb is not working.
Right, right.
So then we have to do three, four, and three, and then three, and out.
I see.
So, and there are moments like this. Look, the beginning of the first movement, for instance. Why, wish you would come with me.
Yes,
because
well.
That is, you see, that is such a difficult moment in the piece. And nobody ever does anything. I'm going to tell the conductors in future.
Would they sing,
yeah, that's very good. Michael, can I just ask a tiny little favor? This is a lovely tempo, but could it be just a whiskerless, because I don't, you find it's a little rush?
You have to do it, Marisa.
I can't.
Yes, you can, because you're the one who's doing all the knitting there.
The knitting. You wait
so
until I get out of the studios. The
knitting. You know what I actually
the second time he said it.
Well, let me lead you into the solo, because I want to feel your tempo.
Yes.
And also the kind of gallant excitement of the tempo, so it doesn't seem slow, but seems...
Shall we try that?
Important.
But the boss is here. Jim is the boss about this, you know.
Not really. Mozart's
you start.
Boss.
He has the melody.
So you're playing four slurs.
We could discuss this business of playing the flute and relate it to acting, which I'm sure you can relate to. You know, if you want to do something funny, you try and get in a good mood inside yourself in order to tell the joke.
Yeah, is it a sort of make-believe that you
Yes,
you
when you're
into?
When you're playing something happy, you have to be something in a benevolent mood. Like to love the piece.
Yes.
And so therefore you don't think about the latest Irish joke right then.
Right, right.
You try to evoke a mood of beauty and of serenity almost.
Yeah.
But I know for me that as a kid growing up in the 20th century, I found it much easier to accept this sort of tonality at first. That seemed like my life was like this, the world was this.
Yeah, it still is.
To sit down and play a piece which is about a world that's this, it's very difficult. You have to kind of find it in yourself first, since it's not there in the outside world so much.
Mm-hmm. By the way, what happens if the conductor starts it off at a tempo you're not too fond of?
Oh, we just slow up.
You just
we
slow
come
up.
In, yeah.
Oh, nothing. No. People don't notice it or anything like that. No.
Well, no, we try to get it the same. You know, we try to agree on the tempo.
Yeah.
But you know, in the heat of the moment, sometimes it doesn't work. You know, for example, the first movement where it goes ba da 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 da. Most conductors do it too quick because they get all enthusiastic, come out to everybody clapping and applauding. Wow, great concert! Hey. Da 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 da.
Yeah.
We're wow.
Excuse me.
I think you still don't completely trust me that I'm not going to push you here. Yum, bup, bum, yum.
Who does that?
Me.
Jimmy or me?
Well, I think in the second half of the bar, you think this guy's going to push me, but I'm not going
to. Let me see, because I don't really feel it. I think it's in your subconscious.
Here we go.
I find it difficult to come to grips with early Mozart because of
the courtly aspect, the innumerable cadences, innumerable Rococo sort of twiddlings that go on. I find it sort of difficult.
But it's these utterly simple pieces. The more famous they are and the more simple they are, the more difficult they become. I mean, so this is why for someone to have to sing La Donne Mobile is almost impossible.
Yes, yes.
The challenge of playing a Mozart concerto is that he does such beautiful things, but there's so many different ways that they could be played. See, Mozart writes here forte, but he doesn't mean... It just means sink in to the
sink
sound.
In. Why didn't he put sink in then? Sink in.
He knew someone like you would misinterpret it to be...
I must have the honor of playing that gorgeous second movement theme with you.
I'm ready.
You're ready. You're ready to go. It's taking me a bit of
not
time.
Not too
long. First movement goes on forever. Oh, here we are. I won't play the first bit. Okay.
Well, now without you.
I'm very moved. There's something in that phrase, which I sang extraordinarily beautifully. It's something in that phrase that is very memorable.
Actually, he was a genius, and everybody knows that, and if they don't, they're idiots.
How are we going to do this? With this? Are we going to sort of... I always think Wiedersehen's there.
But I like to play it out a bit
little
more
fuller.
Because it's such a beautiful...
But that's the thing, of course, with these Mozart pieces, that you have this manuscript which is full of such wonderful subtext and turns,
right,
and very little actual instruction about what you have to do. You have to figure out what it is yourself.
Right. Well, we'll see what sounds best at the time.
But I want you two to play it so that it really is a model for us in terms of...
Thought we were.
You already done it by the time we do it.
You're a powerhouse, Marisa, what can I say?
The best thing with her is say nothing.
James and I have been playing together this concerto now for about 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, just by looking at Jimmy, most of the times through the strings, because and, you know, this is
like
my eternal possession.
We should have telephones, you know. Are you all right, Mum?
Yeah. No. You know, this business of the strings is always between people, but we can always just do this.
Yeah,
tell them that we can.
Hello,
do you see how it feels now?
Yeah.
I still feel it. I don't feel it.
Michael, we're not going to change. We've been doing it like this for 30 years. We have to see a psychiatrist for a month before we can change it.
Oh, I love that. I think
think of me as a marriage counselor.
Excuse me.
Good play. Listen to me.
Better.
Just as a little. Just instead of being like this, it's like making people look,
yes,
come to you.
It is much better.
Well, thank you, sir.
Oh, really? Sounds beautiful.
We try to find out what the depth of emotion is in this music, which is contained in it. If it's happy, if it's sad, if it's nostalgic, or if it's heroic. And we try to evoke all these feelings when we play. And Mozart certainly had a very, very wide gamut, yeah, of feeling. And I think he was a guy who really enjoyed doing things and really enjoyed life. He had a real joie de vivre about his music.
I think that's what makes music hang on, actually, is the optimism, is that joy, really, the hope that we all want to have.
And it took me a long time to slow down enough to reconcile myself to this simple beauty of these Mozart phrases and what a challenge it was to ask a performer just to play something like... There's nothing to it, but you can spend a lifetime thinking about it.
Thank you. Thank you.
But then here, then I go back again to the tempo we started, right?
Good.
So this. Right. Yes. So we just have this nice relaxed moment.
Too slow for me.
For you?
Yeah.
Well, don't listen.
Okay. But, well, but I want to.
How's that?
Yeah, just as long as it keeps direction. I felt before it was just lingering.